your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sore, still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet calls, so lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes. And these are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest, the fields are as white in the world. And we are your laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, trumpet calls, lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet calls, lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee, out of Zion's hill salvation comes. There's no God like Jehovah, 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 there's no God like Jehovah. 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 Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet calls, so lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet calls, so lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee, out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet calls, lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee,
out of
Zion's hill salvation. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout and with the voice of the archangel. The dead in Christ shall rise first, and we who are alive and remain will be caught up in the cloud to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore we comfort one another with these words. I don't know about you, man, I'm not looking for the undertaker. I'm looking for the upper taker. I'm not looking for the hole in the ground. I'm looking for the hole in the sky. Friday night, we went out towards Ward's Road area, caught the sunset, and it was amazing because there were holes in the clouds. And the sun was brilliantly just bursting through those holes in the clouds. I'm talking about big holes. And it was amazing. And I couldn't help but think, one day, there's going to be a hole in the cloud. And we're going to be raptured out of this world, and we're going to be taken up to be with Jesus. And man, what a day that's going to be. Could it be today? Sure could. See, God's not worried about the Super Bowl and who's going to win, who's not going to win, or whether you watch it or whether you don't watch it, or what's going to happen or anything else. I'm today more concerned about who's coming. And the King is coming. Amen. And I'm looking forward that we're going to be changed in the moment of the twinkling of an eye. Let's pray. Call upon this great, righteous, holy God that He is today. And believe Him for what He's got in store for us, and we know it's all good. Father, we come into Your presence with thanksgiving. We enter into Your courts with praise. We declare, this is the day the Lord hath made. We didn't come in to look sad, defeated, discouraged, and be washed out, and think that life is coming to an end, that we have no hope. Oh, Lord, we've got hope. We've got joy unspeakable and full of glory. We're in the presence of a mighty God who does miraculous things. And we just praise You today that You let us see another sunrise. Thank You that, Lord, You let us be on Your planet that is called Earth, that we could breathe Your oxygen, that we could walk, we could stand upright, we could lift our hands, we can talk, we can praise the Lord. We could come to church today to worship You. And I pray today that, Lord, we won't take these things for granted, that, Lord, right now we'll just say, thank You, Lord. That right now we'll say, thank You, Lord. That right now we'll say, thank You, Lord, for Your blessings on us. And I just pray that You'll outpour Yourself in such a rich, manifold way that, Lord, we're going to be overtaken by You today. And, Lord, that we're just going to be so excited about what You're going to do in this house of worship today. Bless, Lord, the music. Bless today the prayers. Bless the offering and bless the people. And, God, You be blessed with our worship today. May the words of our mouth, the meditation of our heart be acceptable in Thy sight, O Lord, our wonderful and glorious Redeemer. Have Your way in this place today. O God, pull our attention to You and help us to look to You today, praise You, and thank You, for great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. We pray this prayer in the most wonderful name that we know, the name Jesus today. To God be the glory. And all God's children said, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. It's a great day to be alive in Lynchburg, Virginia at 411 Blue Ridge Street in the church where the shout has not gone out called what? Gethsemane Baptist Church. Amen. Let's have a good time today.
What do you say to someone who feels like they've lost it all over the edge? With no one there to break their fall.
What do you say to someone who feels so unloved, giving themselves away a little bit every day just to be good enough?
What do you say to a hopeless soul who can't remember their way home and everything is out of their control?
There is no valley, there is no darkness, there is no sorrow greater than the grace of Jesus. There is no moment.
Let folks know you're glad to see them. Shake the hand, hug the neck. Fire's coming down. Praise the Lord. It's a great day, and we're glad that you're with us on this first Sunday in February. And oh my, we're going to have a great time in God's house today. And I'm so glad you've tuned your dial on a live TV on Shentel Cable. And you're going to be blessed by this program from Gethsemane Baptist Church. We pray for you, and we trust God's blessings for you today. All our friends down in Withfield, Bedford, different areas, New River Valley, over in Rocky Mount, Central Virginia, Western Virginia, we just send you greetings in the name of the Lord God Almighty. He is a great and mighty God, and may He bless you today. We're going to be preaching. We're going back to the book of Genesis today, and we're talking about our Creator. And I'm glad that we do have a Creator, that in the beginning, God, He's always been and He will always be. So I pray that your heart will be blessed by the Word. Stay tuned for today. Other great events happening at Gethsemane. Come and experience what God is doing in this place. Bless you today. Amen.
From your passion and pride, there's power in the blood. Power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. Because there's power, power, wonder working power. It's in the blood.
It's in the blood
of the Lamb.
Of the Lamb.
There is power, 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 wonder working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be whiter, much whiter than snow? There's power in the blood, yes, there's power in the blood. Sin stains are lost in this life-giving flow. There's wonderful power in the blood, it's in the blood. There is power, 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 wonder-working power, it's in the blood
of the Lamb. There is power, wonder-working power,
it's in the precious blood.
Of the Lamb, come on, come.
Would you do service for Jesus, your King?
There is power in the blood,
power in the blood. Would you live daily His praises to sing?
Come on now.
There's wonderful power.
It's in the blood. Yeah.
There is power,
power, power, power, power, wonder-working power.
It's in the blood.
In the blood
of the Lamb.
Of the Lamb.
Power
in the precious blood of the Lamb. For there is power, 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 power,
wonder-working power. It's in the blood,
in the blood
of the Lamb.
Of the Lamb.
There is power,
power, power, power,
wonder-working
power. I like that.
In the precious blood
of the Lamb. Let's go back and sing that chorus a couple more times. Come on, put your hands together, get excited about this great God. There is power, 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 power,
power, wonder-working power. It's in the blood of the Lamb.
Come on, church.
There is power,
power, power, power,
wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
For there is power,
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 wonder-working power,
it's in the blood
of the Lamb.
Yeah.
There is power,
power, power, power,
wonder-working power
in the precious blood
of the
Lamb. Praise God. Give the Lord some praise in the house today. Amen.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, is well with my soul. It is well,
it is well
with my soul.
With my soul,
it is well. It is well with my soul. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin. Nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord,
praise the Lord, oh my soul.
And Lord, haste the day the clouds be rolled back as a scroll. The trump shall resound, and my Lord shall descend. Even so,
to the title, simply stated, the Creator. Taken from Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 through 5. Preacher, are we ever going to get out of Genesis in the first five verses? I don't know. We may not, but we'll do our best. If we do, we do. If we don't, we don't. Is that okay? Amen. Amen. But over the past several weeks, I did take a week off from it last week, but over the last several weeks, I preached from Genesis chapter 1. First, I preached on our gracious Creator. The second message was simply, I preached the message, the glory of our Creator, and today I'm preaching on the Creator. You know, I want you to get this in your spirit and understand that only God can create. Only He can create today, and the opening declaration in Genesis 1 reminds us that we're totally dependent upon God, because it simply says, in the beginning, God. Before you ever thought, He's always been. And He shall always be. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's infinite. There's no end. He's Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. He's everything today. And so our God then not only is a God of eternity, but our God is also a God of sovereignty. And when we say that He's a God of sovereignty, it means that our God is in control. You say, man, I got a lot of mess going on in my life, and I don't know what I'm going to do. God is in control. Well, all these folks that are going through sickness and trial, I don't know what we're going to do. God is in control. You got some dilemmas going on in your life. You may have walked in this building today and you're just at a point that you just don't know what to do. You're about ready to either throw in the towel or throw up your hands and quit. God is still in control. And you've got to grasp that and get that in your spirit. So understand today that creation shows us God's grace, and the grace is life. His grace is life for you and I today. For by grace are you saved through faith and not of yourselves. It's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. You went into a relationship by grace through faith. You asked Jesus Christ to forgive you of your sins, to come into your heart and your life and save you. I pray you have, and if you haven't, you need to. I'm going to tell you right now, you're not going to get to heaven without Christ and his blood. So God's goodness calls for our allegiance to him. We need to get a grasp on that, because sometimes we're just not as focused on God the way that we should be. He is not really the God of our priorities. He's not the God of our life. He is the God that we just pull out of a hat like a rabbit to pull a trick for us with. We just use God as an occasional get me through or get me by or get me whatever. No, he's got to be God of all your life. And you owe him today. You owe him allegiance. Because let me tell you, if God didn't do anything else for you but reach down into the shame and the degradation and the sin of your life and save your soul, man, that's enough to go outside and shout for 30 minutes over. The fact is, today we've got a lot to praise God for, don't we? I said we got a lot to praise God for he is a good God and a righteous God and a glorious God and deserving of all praise from his people. It doesn't mean that you're problematically free of trouble and trial in your life. You're going to have those things. We all have those things. But one thing is a certainty today. We've got a God, one who's on our side, and we've got a God who makes no mistakes, and we've got a God who's still in control. So going to Genesis 1 today, and starting with 1, reading down through verse 5, it says, "In the beginning God created the heaven and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw the light." Now, something happens here. There's some real strong scriptural truths in the first five verses of Genesis 1. And so many times we just say, "In the beginning, God." And that's about all we get to. It's more to it. God saw the light, that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day. May God add the blessing to the reading of his word. In the beginning, God is a foundational truth for all theology. By that I mean, if you cannot get in the beginning God right, you can't get none of the rest of it right. If you can't get your hands around that and believe that today, you're totally missing the whole thing. So in the beginning God then becomes the very bedrock today of what you build your life upon and what you build your family upon, because you've got to get that solid rock of belief in your system today. We respect science and we respect all the other things that are out there, but let me tell you what, for the most part, the scientists are dead wrong. God created the heaven and the earth. God spoke. God gave the light. God divided the light from darkness. God gave breath to animal life. God gave vegetation. God created man in his own image. So, you know, looking at all of that today, folks, you may try to apply an application of science to it, but I'm going to tell you right now, it's got God's hands all over it. The creative acts in Genesis 1 has God's DNA all over it. And if you've been born again, God's DNA is all over you, because he's touched your life and changed you today. You've got the blood of Jesus now that has blotted out your transgressions and removed your iniquities and birthed you into the family of God. And now you're belonging to him and you're his child. And he's watching over you and supplying your every need. And he's prepared a heaven for you today. Let me tell you what, God's hand, his DNA, his presence is on you, in you, and about you at all times. Amen. So realizing that today, this God, you can build your life upon him, but you can't build nothing on him until you first enter into a relationship with him. You're not saved by religiosity. You're not saved by doing this or doing that or keeping the rules and the do's and the don'ts and all these other applications that we find ourselves in sometimes. You are saved by the grace of God. You're saved by the blood of Jesus. You are delivered by the hand of our great and mighty God. So if you can't get this in the beginning God correct, you then have totally missed the whole meaning of the Bible. You've got to get this correct. Now, there's a lot of things because as we disclosed here over a couple of weeks that there's a strong meaning of salvation. There's a strong meaning here of the sovereignty of God. But there's even more. We are sitting in this sanctuary today, and every person that has entered this place of worship has entered with some type of need in their life. Every one of you have some type of need residing in your life, and you may have multiple needs. Oh, I tell you, sometimes I think, oh, Lord, will it ever let up? And, you know, then I go over and I visit people in the hospital, what I've been doing for the last week or so intensely, and I see what people are going through, and I think, gee, maybe, Carlton, you don't have it so bad after all. We all have needs in our life. And those needs can resonate within a spiritual application, or they can resonate within a family application, or in a mental application, or in a relational application. I mean, there's so many things today that involve our life. So people walked into the sanctuary today, and I'm going to tell you, you might be here, I don't know. You might be here today, and you're just barely holding on. You're just basically, you're hanging by your fingernails on the cliff of life, and you don't know which way to turn. So this In the Beginning God will lift today the faint-hearted, and this one today that is called In the Beginning God will awaken those that are dead in sin. If you're here today and you're lost, I'm telling you, He will awaken you to the need of salvation and save your soul. He will even strengthen those. You may feel wasted and absolutely weak, and you don't feel like, man, I just don't know if I can go on anymore. It's God who will carry you through what you're facing. He will give strength to the weak. And when you come, this is what I found in my personal life. When I come to the end of me and realize it's not me and I can't do nothing, but my God can do all things, which strengthens me. Who is my refuge and my strength? Who is my high tower? Who is the love of my life? Who is the God who's on my side? Who is the God that will bring me through whatever I'm facing in life? I then realize, man, you know what? It's not about me. It's about the God that is in me. Amen. And how powerful and how marvelous and how miraculous this God is. We can today come to that beginning and realize today all of our hope resides in the Creator called God. Amen. God's name is grossly misused. I'm serious. People misuse the name of God. We use him like a bellhop. Oh, God, I need help. Oh, God, get me through that. Oh, God. And we basically misuse God. You know why we misuse God? Because we don't have that allegiance to him. We don't have that heart sold out to him. And so therefore, we're totally missing the mark. God's not your bellhop. God's not your call boy. He don't come when you snap your finger. As a matter of fact, we should bow before him in adoration and thanksgiving for what he has done for us, and the mere fact today that he has seen fit to send his son to die for us on the cross and to make a way for us. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. I know where my help comes from. Today, we've gathered in this place. And folks, we heard the beautiful music. Didn't our folks do a beautiful job on music today? Amen. We've heard the scriptures today from God's precious word throughout this day since we've arrived here. And now you're hearing a message from God. And so this is what we call church. We're in church today. It's not the building that makes the church the church. It's the God in the hearts and the lives of people that makes the church the church. So realizing this, we describe, though, unfortunately, we get to church and we start describing church on a how and when basis. We're totally missing a point here. People describe the how and when. You know, what church has done, what time the church services are, what songs we're going to use, what we're going to do here, what we're going to do there, what all these things. And so we get to a place where it's all about the how and the when, but we totally miss the point about really what church is all about, and that's the why. Why we do church. I mean, why are you here today? Well, I just showed up. Well, God didn't want you just to show up. He wants you to show up in recognition that he is a great and mighty God. Amen. So we're here today in the sanctuary of this church to praise our mighty God. We didn't come to have a funeral service today because our Savior, our God's not dead. We've come to, this is the most exciting place you should be on planet Earth. I mean, listen, there's some great places and things, and I know some of you tonight are going to be tearing up your house. You're going to turn on that giant screen TV, and you're going to see these titans get out on a football field and crack heads together and chase after a pig's bladder, and you're going to get all excited about that, and you're going to eat everything you can get your hands on, and you're going to throw, I mean, you're going to go crazy. I mean, you might throw the kids out the window. I don't know what you're going to do. But you're going to get, then if your team don't win, then you're going to get an attitude. Then you're going to try to explain away why there's, well, I, you know, I do well, my team, well, those referees were a bunch of sorry scumbags. They didn't know, they didn't make the right, you know, we use all the terminology of justifying. You know what? I could give a rip about that. As far as I'm concerned, if we just camped out in here all day long and sung and preached and prayed, man, I can't think of a better thing to do. Amen. Hallelujah. We'll send Horace Anderson out for some chicken. No, don't do that. Because he'll never come back. He'll eat all the chicken and not come back. No, we're not eating chicken livers. We've got to get this man converted, y'all. He's eating all this trash food, organ food. They don't do nothing but kill you. Amen. We've got to get him converted. Amen. From trash food. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm just kidding. How do we describe church? We have gathered here together today to worship our God and to realize that He is the source of everything in our life. When you open God's Word to Genesis 1 and you read through verses 3 through 5, we find these powerful verses today that basically what they do, they strip away the varnish today of Christian worship. Because to be frank with you, a lot of people are out there worshiping today, but they're not worshiping God. They're going through motions of religion. They're going through rituals and rules and all this. And well, I did show up in church and I, you know, I did go to the confessional and confess my sins to a man that's dressed like mother and we call him father. And he tells us the penance that we'll commit. I'm not hitting on Catholics. I'm just telling you. There's one mediator between God and man. That's the man Christ Jesus. Right. Amen. There's only one that can forgive my sins, and he's on the throne, but also lives within my heart and my life. So realizing this day, a lot of people are, they're worshiping for the wrong reason. So we've got to get our worship right. So we find these powerful verses. They strip away a lot of the things that we think are Christian worship that's not God's way. Our worship is not about the how and the when. It's about God. It's about the who. So the question about why unites us. Did you know that? See, when we get into all these little nitpicking details of issues, they divide us. But when we make God our focal point, God unites us. He unifies us. So we then start to look at the goodness of God and the sinfulness of all humanity, and we see the redeeming power of Jesus Christ today, that we are not divided, but now in Christ we have been united. We are the body of the living God. Amen. So Genesis does not divide us. Actually, if you look at the word in Genesis, Genesis unites us. It bonds us. It pulls us into a closer relationship. So Genesis reminds us, here's the fact that you've got to get in your spirit. Genesis reminds us there is a God. There is a God. Oh, I don't care what these protesters and liberals and nuts and fruits and all the other idiots that are out there that debate and disclose and try to prove there is no God. Let me tell you what, man. When I walked out my house or when I woke up even this morning and was able to call on my Heavenly Father, I know there is a God. When I entered into His sanctuary of worship today and magnified His name and worshiped Him and heard the melodious music and saw the expressions on people, how God was working in their life, you can't tell me there's not a God. When I see sinners come to this altar and repent of their sin and ask Jesus Christ to come into their heart and life, and they get saved, hallelujah, and they went down a pauper, they went down shattered, broken, they went down poor, they went down going to hell, but when they got up as a redeemed child of God, rich in the mercy and the grace of our God, and their whole life has been changed. They don't tell me there's not a God. When I see people bring their heartbreaks and their struggles and their tears and everything else that they've gone through, and this weekend I spent a lot of time with a lot of people going through a lot of stuff, And I tell you, sometimes you just say in your spirit, God, what can I say? He said, you just open your mouth, I will speak through you. And sometimes it's hard to find the words, but God always puts them there. Because people have needs, but then you see the comfort, you feel the peace, the serenity of God when you stand in cubicles where basically people are seriously ill. And you pray and you feel the presence of God in that cubicle, in that room. And His Spirit just comes down and all the peace. It's just like He puts His arms around you. He just gets you up real close to His voice and He whispers into your spirit, peace I give unto you. My peace I place within you. This peace that brings stillness and calm in your soul. Tell me there's no God. Sorry. Our God is real. And our God's alive. I thought y'all was going to sleep on me. I thought I need to wake you up. I tell you one thing. Nothing wrong with my voice, is it? Genesis put here is put here. And you know what? It's just not to silence the scientific ideas that people have. Genesis is put here as a means of worship. Amen. Genesis is about our worship. So Genesis is put here to remind us that our God is a good God. Our God is a real God. And so creation shows us why we should worship God. Now let me give you three quick points. I don't have a poem, but anyway, I'll give you three quick points and get you out of here. Number one, creation shows us the importance of God's judgment. See, here's the point. I believe today that our world, our nation, and our churches have forgotten that our God is a God of judgment. We live like there is no God because we think there is no judgment. So what does God think about when He looks at your life? Answer that one there for yourself. What does God think about when He looks at your life? And let me tell you, He knows you. He even has the hairs on your head numbered. Any of the ones that fell out. He even knows how many freckles are on you. Amen. He knows every detail about you. He knows the thoughts and intents of your heart. He knows everything that goes on in your life. And so realizing this, what does God think about your life? Not what you think about it. What does God think about it? I mean, we pamper ourselves and we look at ourselves. Oh, Lord. I mean, I've read some of the garbage that people put on Facebook, and I don't know what mirror they're looking in. But let me tell you what. They need to change mirrors. Amen. They pump themselves up so much, and they boost their ego so much. And I just like to take a pen and go, it's not about your ego. It's not about you. It's all about Him. Amen. When you realize how great He is today, your life will start changing. You'll start talking different, acting different, and you'll start respecting God in the capacity that you should today. So, and God said, let there be light, and there was light, and God saw the light, and the light was that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. So this is the very first judgment that actually happened in the Bible. Did you know that? This is the first judgment that happened in God's Word. God alone is your judge. So you think, well, God's my judge, and he's entirely holy. Yes, He is. And so this God who is my judge looks down on your life today, and He knows every intricate detail about you and I today. So Isaiah got a glimpse of this God on His throne, and it's amazing what Isaiah said in Isaiah 6. And remember that Isaiah, I think one of the holiest men in the Old Testament was Isaiah, the great prophet of God. And and I'll read to you what he said. He says, and I saw also the Lord setting. He saw also the Lord setting. He saw the Lord upon a throne high lifted up, and His train, His presence filled the temple. You know what? God wants to fill your life with His presence. And one cried unto another and said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of His glory. Then said I, he said, woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, for mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. What Isaiah was saying is, judgment was upon him. You've got to see yourself as you are. I hate to pop your bubble, but you're not the greatest thing since white sliced bread. As a matter of fact, we're nothing. Wretched, poor, blind, halt. Miserable, not even deserving to even say his name. Oh, but God in his mercy and his love, that's what you find there in Genesis 2. In this worship, you find the mercy, the grace, and the love of God that didn't leave us like he found us. He redeemed us. He brought us into his company, into his presence today. Let me tell you what. Be careful when you say, I've heard people say, only God can judge me. That might be more frightening than you perceive. Because let me tell you, you may escape some judgment here, but you're not going to escape the judgment there. Amen. And as a matter of fact, God can even bring judgment upon you here because of the way you live. God created light. He looked at it and he made a judgment call because God said, it is good. See, that was a judgment call. So there's your first judgment in the Bible. Then God makes seven other judgment calls when he declared of his creation, and it is good. So seven times God said, what? It is good. This shows us that God alone has the right to evaluate you and I and his will in our life. And folks, God takes it serious. You may flip it off, but God takes it serious. How you're living for him, he takes it serious because you're representing the King of Kings and the Lord. Oh, I'm saved, preacher. I'm saved, man. I'm blood washed. I'm going to heaven. Got my name written there. I mean, I'm right there, man. Yeah, but are you living what you say you believe? I mean, are you the Christian that God would be proud of? Are you the Christian that God would be proud to have your picture on his refrigerator? Is God really, would he really today be delighted? What is he going to say to us when we stand before him? Unfortunately, you know, God's judgment, God's evaluation has been ignored, not only by the world, but I'm here to tell you it's been ignored today by Christians today. Most would rather be light than to be holy. I want everybody to like me. Well, I'm sorry, not everybody's going to like you. And you being liked is second fiddle to you being holy before the presence of God. So what would happen if we only cared about what God thought? What would happen if we only cared about what God said? What God has directed in our lives today? If we really believe what creation shows, that God then, our values would be realigned, that God would be first in our life. So God is the one today who determines the good and what's good and what's not. What's not, he calls sin. And after God created light, then God made the evaluation, the judgment, that it was good. And so what does, you know, what God created was pure, and it was for the pleasure of God. Your life should be all about him. Remember, God sees everything, and God makes a judgment. This is a centerpiece, basically, of all our problems. Because we won't do anything about the sin in our life. Come on, church. We won't get right. We won't give God our allegiance. God forbid tonight that you keep your nose and your eyes glued tonight to a television set and ignore the house of the Lord. That's not honored in that. God looks at you in his infinite knowledge and he makes a judgment. And, you know, is what we're living pleasing to God? It's what you do pleasing to God. It's what comes out of your mouth. Please, how in God's name can you say, I'm a professing Christian, and come to church and sing, oh, how I love Jesus, and go out into the world and use his name in vain and damn his name by your conversation? Shame on you. Well, preacher, I'm trying to clean up my life. That's your problem. You're trying to clean it up, and you're ignoring the best cleaning process, the purification process that is found in the pages of God's Word. You need to let God do the work today. For the Word declares, God looks at all of us and says, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. You know, this is a terrible judgment, because this judgment says that the wages of sin is death. But also he says the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. That death is eternal separation from God. So we are not perfect, but we are sinners. You, every, including me, we're all sinners today. And God judges sinners. You're going to be judged. And this is not the end of the story. God sees us as sinners. Thank you, Jesus. And for us to escape the judgment of God, we've got to run to the cross of Christ. We've got to run to Jesus. And I'm glad he's a forgiving God. I'm glad he'll blot out your transgressions and remove your iniquities today. Hallelujah. We can plead the blood of Jesus today, for only his blood can wash our sins away. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. So God looked at the righteous life of the Lord Jesus Christ, and he looked at the punishment today that he endured, and God then gave a judgment and said, you are forgiven. Glory to God. You are forgiven. And if you need forgiveness today, his forgiveness is not exhausted. You come to him, you say, God, I've sinned, and God, I've messed up, and God, I've done this, and God, forgive me. I'm telling you, on the authority, as soon as those words come out of your spirit and your heart and your life, God forgives you. Amen. And maybe you need some of that today. Because you're not, I'm not, none of us are perfect. We need forgiveness. We need to be forgiven. Hallelujah. I'm so glad today, even when we deserve hell because of the cross of Christ, we now stand under the grace of our God. So God sees and he judges, and in Christ he declares that we have now experienced recreation. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. Number two, and these two, next two are short. Creation shows us the scope of God's authority. So how much right does God have to step into your life? Every bit of it. There's a key phrase of distinction in verse 4. He says, and God saw the light and it was good. God divided the light from the darkness. So God separated the light. He separated it from the darkness, and then we find that there's a distinction. There's light, and then there's darkness. So he called the day, the light day, and the darkness night. So there's a distinction in John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. That's the fact. Here comes the distinction, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. So those who don't believe in him will perish. Those who believe and receive will have eternal life with him. God's saving love is expressed in no other than the Lord Jesus Christ. So it's reserved for those today who come to him by faith in Christ. You've got to have Christ in your life. So God makes distinctions that there are only two groups of people, good people and those that are not good people. But preacher, saved and lost. See, you in one or two categories, and you're not jumping from one to another. You either are or you are not. You either saint or you ain't. And I'm not trying to be cute and poetic here, okay? God's people, let me tell you, are those who are not controlled by self anymore. They're controlled by the power and the presence of God. So you can take Genesis 1 and you can connect it to John 1, which really Genesis 1 and John 1 are so intertwined together. It's amazing, because here's the recreation, and the recreation is found in Jesus. And I'm telling you today, if you're not saved, I don't care what church you're a member of. I don't care what your past has been. I don't care how sorry or how good you are. The fact is, that's all immaterial. There's only one sin that's going to keep you out of heaven, and that's the sin of rejecting Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. You must be born again. And the being born again, the recreation, is you acknowledge you are a sinner. You recall that Jesus died for you on the cross, and you receive him into your heart. Therefore, you then, upon that reception, you are saved. So it's found in the I ams of Jesus. In John, he says, I am the true vine. I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the door. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus said, we are in the world, but we're not of the world. Amen. So God didn't call you to just be a nice person. God called you to be a child of God and to live what you say that you believe. The bulk of Christianity is our lives have been transformed. Or have you? And if you've been transformed, are you living the transformation that you have received? We were once dead, but now we've been made alive in Christ. The transformation of salvation is that great distinction today. We are separated. God separates darkness and light in creation, and God separates darkness and light in our lives when we're saved. We no longer pursue the darkness of sin and shame and degradation and all the wickedness of this world. We now are in pursuit of God. We want to live holy and separated lives for Christ. Has that happened to you? Yeah, I didn't ask you if you're just saved. I'm asking you today, are you saved? And then I'm asking you today, are you sold out to Jesus? Is your allegiance to Him? Can God count on you? Can God today depend upon what you are and what you profess and that He lives within you today? See, folks, if you still have the same old sinful habits, the same old lifestyles, the same old attractions, something's wrong with your salvation. Third point, creation shows us the joy of a new day. And the evening and the morning were the first day. Every evening is followed by a new morning, isn't it? So glad to see the sun come up this morning. That every day, listen, every dark night of the soul is followed by the sun coming up. We're reminded that God's never-ending, complete steadfastness is faithful and love. He is a faithful God. Jeremiah said, His mercies are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. David said, Your weeping may endure for a night, but what? Joy comes in the morning. Hallelujah. This points us to the gospel of Jesus. See, the life of Jesus led to the cross, the crucifixion, the darkness that covered the earth. You remember that? And that darkness was dispelled when Jesus says, It is finished! Glory to God. He had accomplished what the Father had sent Him to do. Darkness was followed by, on that Sunday, 3 days later, the light. Because they rolled away the stone. And He was not there, for as the angel of the Lord said, He is risen, amen. The darkness of sin and the shame of sin and all the darkness of the world was shattered by the light of God's love through His Son, Jesus Christ. Praise God. So the cross was not the end of the story. The cross is the beginning of the story. And if you don't have the cross in your life, you're on a dead end street. The punishment from God was rendered on Christ. He bore our sins and carried our sorrows, the Word of God says. He was a man of sorrows and afflicted and bore the shame of our sins. The resurrection tells us something today that we have, thank God. And as I close, I tell you what we've got. We've got hope. We have hope in Christ today. You know, perhaps today you're going through some dark valleys and times of your life right now. Maybe it's in your walk with the Lord. Maybe it's in your walk in the life that God has given you. Maybe it's in your home. Maybe it's in the challenges of your health. But I'm going to tell you today, there's hope today. There's hope, for there is a light. And that light is the Lord Jesus Christ. And He wants to light up your life and change you. Because of the resurrection of Jesus today, you do have hope. And you know what's so amazing about this? You can come and bring all those places that you're struggling with today of darkness, and you can permit His life to penetrate the darkness and change you today. He is the Creator. Why don't you let Him recreate your life today? Let Him take the dark valleys and let Him turn those dark valleys to victory right now. Stand to your feet, please. Your altars are open for you today. God wants to move on your life. You don't have to wait until the preacher prays. You don't have to wait until the music starts. Right now, God's calling His people to come to an altar today and just surrender all unto God. Maybe you're in the valleys of the shadows today. Maybe you're going through the dark places of your life. Let me tell you, your victory is right here. If you stay where you are and what you're in today, you're going to stay in the darkness of where you're at. But God says, come on, step into the light. Come on. Come on, step into the light. Who'll be the first one to step into the light today? Father, move upon us right now. May the Spirit of our Savior today help us. And, oh God, lift our hearts as we worship You today, as we declare how great and how good our God is. You can change every life and every heart that will come. Will You come today? Will You come? Come on. He's calling you.